Ladies and gentlemen, please rise for the presentation of colors. Our national anthem will be sung by Sandra Lynn.
Stripes and bright stars.
Ladies and gentlemen, your program hosts, Sean D. Tucker and Danny Clisham.
Yeah, baby. I want to ask Mr. Hoover, are you looking down on us?
You bet your ass I am.
Mr. Hoover, you can take care of us?
You bet your ass I am, you magnificent friends.
There's so many in this room. There's so many people in this room who wouldn't be alive today without Bob, R.A. Bob Hoover. He lived 10 lives. He lived 900 years. He lived the life of Abraham. And we're here today to celebrate that essence, what is called R.A. Bob Hoover. Because these people, every single one of us in this room, he inspired, he empowered, and we have a part of him in our DNA now, and we take that and we celebrate that, and if we're all a little bit like Bob Hoover, this world is going to be a better place. That's for sure. And Danny, now we talk about housekeeping.
All right, now sometimes you don't know how to handle these things, these celebrations, these memorials, these tributes, but I'm going to tell you what we're going to do. Sean just pretty much presented it to you. We're going to do this in the spirit of joy, unmitigated joy that Bob gave you, gave me, gave all of us, and gave the entire world. So think of that throughout the course of this entire event. I want to see smiles. I want to see upbeat. I want to see unmitigated happiness, because that's exactly what Bob would want. Do you agree with me on that? All right.
Wait a minute. Did I hear a yeah, baby?
Yeah.
Yeah, baby. All right.
All right. Now, the next thing, also at events like this, we have great speakers, and it is hard to know sometimes if you're in a funeral service at a funeral home, somebody does a great job of speaking, like all of our featured speakers. You don't know what to do. Do you clap? Do you not clap? What's dignified? But again, because we're in this celebration of joy, when our speakers who are paying tribute to Bob Hoover get finished, I want to hear a resounding air show round of applause. You'll do that for me? All right, that's the way we're going to do it. Sean Tucker, let's rock and roll.
Let's show the video.
I certainly hope you all enjoyed the flight. I've got a real soft spot in my heart for the good old Mustang. Thanks a lot for letting me show off this great little airplane.
Ladies and gentlemen, that tribute video, I agree, is the accomplishment of Ed Shipley, Bob's friend and our dear friend. Give him a big round of applause. Thank you, Ed. Thank you, Ed.
Thanks very much, Ed.
All right, Sean, let's
I got this, Danny. Okay, this is the greatest example of the greatest example, and that's why we're here. We got another one, and we're in his hangar. It is Mr. Clay Lacy. Please, Clay, come up and say a few words. Ladies and gentlemen, Clay Lacy.
Thank you, my friend. Thank you. It's a pleasure to see so many people here, and not a surprise. Bob had so many friends, and he's such a great person that nobody wanted to miss it if he could. I say, people almost question who Bob Hoover was. And a few things, my answers I have, he was the best heavy aircraft aerobatic pilot ever. He was the best pilot on energy management from a long easy to a Globemaster. Best ever outlook and attitude towards other people, including all other pilots. Treated generals and line service personnel as equals. Never a bad word about anybody, gave everyone benefit of the situation. Most gentlemanly person I've ever known, most even personality as well. I met Bob in 1965 when I was flying out of Van Nuys guard here. We were at summer camp in Boise, Idaho, and I happened to be in the maintenance office, and Bob walked in looking for his airplane that he was going to give us a demo on the F-86 and how safe it was. And the chief of maintenance told him that they had chosen the best aircraft for him, at which time he asked, which is the biggest dog you have? And several people said, 239, and Bob replied, I'll take 239. This was Bob's SOP to use the aircraft people thought was the worst airplane in the squadron. I became a friend of Bob and Colleen's and would go out to dinner with them two or three times a year until 1964, when the first Reno races were held. I was the vice president of the unlimited class, so I frequently met with Bob to go over our rules, adjust the rules, or other business we had. I wanted his advice. Starting in 1964, my wife Lois became friends with the Hoovers, and we got together socially every month or two. We traveled together to Europe, Mexico, Idaho, and Texas. Our around the world speed record, 1988, in a Boeing 747, and the Midway Island on January the 1st, the year 2000. It was always a pleasure to travel with Bob and Colleen. The past 2 years had not been easy on Bob because of Colleen's health problems prior to her passing. Being friends with Bob and Colleen has been great. You will always learn something new. Also, through the years, I've met a lot of nice people, their friends, and many of our mutual friends. The service today is representative of his friends, all you people out here. Not all of you are in aviation, probably most of are, but he had friends of every walk of life. He was just fabulous. I've been lucky to know Bob Hoover and to have had the chance to fly with him and hangar fly with him a lot. I've learned so much. Bob's friendship was a high point of my life. Thanks for everything, Bob. I look forward to another time. With a real feeling of loss, I bid you goodbye for now.
Thank you so much, Craig. Our next speaker is probably, aviation is one of the most important things in his life, and he's the greatest spokesperson we have for our love for aviation. That's Mr. Harrison Ford. Harrison.
A great crowd. Bob would be very happy. We're going to hear a lot about Bob's past. We already know it's so worthy of repetition, and we've all been inspired by what Bob did in his life. I think what we need to do now is consider what Bob might want us to do with our lives, the time that's left to us. And one of those things that I feel strongly that he would be pressing us to do would be to make opportunities in aviation available for young people in this country, to create a climate for aviation that is friendlier than it is today, to give young people the opportunity to make a career in aviation, whether it's flying or any other support of aviation. And that leads us to the educational opportunities which can be, which we can help persuade people to pursue. But they have to be available, and it will take an effort of all of us to continue in all of different manner of ways, but I'm thinking principally this, the opportunity for real educational push in STEM for young people. I was honored to know Bob, and he had a real influence in my life, and I will miss him. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, I'd like to invite Brian Cochran to the stage. Brian's a dear friend of Bob's and his business partner. Please, Brian. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Brian. My wife, Joan, my son, Chris, and I have had the privilege of being friends and neighbors of Bob's for 10 plus years. We're forever grateful to the Hoover family for our time with Bob and Colleen. It was truly special. We're also thankful to Rob and Lynn Hoover for the time and the compassionate assistance they chose for Bob with his caregivers, Mary and Gracie. Both were extraordinary and added a huge quality of life to Bob and Colleen's last days. Bob was a great American. What a life. Quote many of us have heard, and I believe it was directly written for Bob, was, "Life shouldn't be a journey to the grave with the intention of arriving safely in a handsome and well-preserved body. Rather, one should skid in broadside in a cloud of smoke, thoroughly used up, totally worn out, but loudly proclaiming, 'Wow, what a ride!'" Bob, thanks for the memories. We all love you.
Probably the orneriest friend Bob Hoover has, who's spent years and years and thousands of hours flying Bob around the country so Bob could give his message. He's really, really just been a magnificent friend to this family, is Mike Herman. Please, Michael.
So, I've been known to be the one who flew Bob around to events, but I think I spent more time in private than we did in public. I know we did. In my 77 years of living, he was truly one of a kind. He was a mentor to me, a parent, and a friend like no other I ever had. I've been asked hundreds of times if I was nervous about flying Mr. Bob Hoover, especially the landings. I never had the pleasure of having Bob in my cockpit because of his difficulty getting into a CJ3. And he never made a comment about my landings, especially when they weren't the best. And that was the typical of how Bob addressed life. When Colleen, his bride of 68 years, passed away, I was with him the following morning. And I asked Bob, "Now that you got your wish to be around to take care of her, what say thee? Is it forward or backward? Have you had enough?" And I told him that either way, whatever his decision was, I'd respect it. And Bob said, it's going to be very, very tough going forward without her, but I don't want to die in bed doing nothing. I want to be with my friends in aviation. My wife Marie and I were to depart for our hometown, Perth, Australia. I visited Bob the day before we left, and he said to me, I'll be packed and ready to roll to NBAA in the beginning of November. I spoke with Bob every day from down under, and on this particular day, the phone was answered by Gracie, one of Bob's two caregivers who we told you about. And Gracie told me he was having a hard time breathing. She gave him the phone, and he got on, and I quote, Mark, I'm so glad you called because I want to have the opportunity to say goodbye. And then he went on to say some very private things to me, and a few hours later, he was gone. Lastly, Bob's instructions, which follows in the wake of Harrison, to Brian Cochran, Tracy Forrest, Rich Pickett, and Tom Poberesny, and myself, was that he would like to leave a legacy to those coming into aviation, especially students and schools, to understand that they could become anything they wanted, just like he did. And Bob did have the greatest of pleasure, because many of us were there at Embry-Riddle University 2 years ago in Daytona, when he had the opportunity, when students, deserving students, were handed scholarships by Bob, shook his hand, spent time with him. One of them flew back to California with us, and Bob, frankly, was very thrilled. It was the start of what his dream was. We were trying to start to fulfill his wishes. So I say fair skies and tailwinds to my friend, and I love you.
Yeah, baby. Please, our next speaker is Dorothy Cochran from the Smithsonian Air and Space Museum, a wonderful dear friend of Bob's, and the curator for Bob's airplane, the Shrike.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's such a pleasure to be here, to be invited to be here for this celebration of life for Robert A. Bob Hoover. On behalf of our Director General Daley, who could not make it, I just want to thank everyone for inviting us and for including us on this day. I'd like to just tell you a little bit about the last air show that we saw Bob fly in the Shrike. The aircraft, after he finished flying it, went to the Sport Aviation Museum in Lakeland, Florida for a few years while we were building the Stephen F. Udvar-Hazy Center. When it was time to bring it up, to place it in the museum, I called the FAA and got a waiver to get Bob into the airplane with his ferry pilot, Steve Clegg. They departed from Lakeland, and the FAA again helped out, giving them some clearances and some go-to-it Bob all the way up the East Coast to the museum. As he approached the Dulles Tower, he called in and requested a flyby of the Don Engen Tower, which is our small tower at the Udvar-Hazy Center. Dulles Tower said, go ahead, Bob, go for it, and called us to let us know he would be doing that. So we were all positioned outside as the Shrike came by and as he banked it so we could see his name and see him fly by in his smooth, usual manner. He then turned and did a downwind between both runways at Dulles Airport, came around and landed on both wheels. He didn't do the Tennessee Waltz, he didn't do one wheel or the other. But he did do a famous high-speed taxi from Dulles to the apron of the Udvar-Hazy Center, where Don Lopez, our World War II ace and deputy director, and Jack Daley were waiting for him. And they were waiting for him to come, stop the plane, get out, and say, I'm here. Well, Bob had other ideas. This was his last air show, after all. He made the final turn that comes around to the open hangar door at the Udvar-Hazy Center, and he taxied right on in. General Daley was aghast. Don Lopez thought it was wonderful and just laughed and had a ball. And it was just one of those marvelous moments. This was his last air show, his last flight in the Shrike, and he was going to do what he always did with the Shrike, which was to fly it in and stop it at Air Show Center, which was in the north end of the Udvar-Hazy Center. Now, if General Daley were here, he would say, Bob Hoover is the only person who has ever taxied an airplane into the Hazy Center, and I'm going to make sure that stands. We are just so honored to have his aircraft. And so I invite you all, if you're on the East Coast, if you want to feel a little touch of Bob, to come by, see the airplane, his flight suit. We've got one of his trademark hats. We've even got a beautiful statue. I think some of you have heard about that. He's online if you want to hear him talk, some of his speeches that he's given. And, you know, it's just a warm feeling to be able to go out by and see that airplane. And I also want to give a little moment just to Colleen, having known her all these years. And I can only imagine, she told me some of the stories of what it was like to be married to Bob Hoover. And just, you know, as a test pilot, as an airshow pilot, he's out and about, he's here, there's fears, there's worries, there's this and that. She was tough, and she did a magnificent job being his wife and enjoying her life. So thank you all.
Thank you, Garth. Very nice. And now we're going to segue. Randy Fry of Fry's Electronics was Bob's last sponsor. And so, Randy, please come up. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sean. You know, that was a great story about Bob taxiing into the hangar. You know, he mentioned to me before he did that, he says, Randy, don't say anything. But I'm going to do that. Just a little bit of background. Like many of you, at 12 years old, my first magazine subscription was Flying Magazine and soon to be an NTSB reporter. This story I'm going to tell took place when I was 39 years old and built a huge affinity for Bob and quite honestly a hero of mine. And I told him that the first time I met him. So must have glasses available for near vision. So I was Bob's sponsor from 1997 until his Shrike Commander was curated by the Smithsonian. I am honored and privileged to share with you a short Bob Hoover story of how we met and became friends. This story begins with a phone call from organizers in the Half Moon Bay, California, asking me to sponsor their air show. I politely declined, but then I had a bright idea. If you can get Bob Hoover to perform at your air show, I would be willing to pay his sponsorship fee. Well, about 3 days later, I got a follow-up phone call. Bob can't make the Saturday show, but he can perform on Sunday for a fee of $5,000, plus one more thing. I'm okay with the sponsorship fee, but what is that one more thing? Well, you see, Bob will be flying in Saturday afternoon from an air show in Santa Barbara just in time to attend our hangar party. The one more thing is, for Saturday evening, Bob requires a special drink be provided by his sponsor. This is a true story, by the way. I said, okay, a special drink? What is Bob's special drink? Bob wants available a 1.75-liter bottle of Tanqueray gin for the enjoyment of himself and some very close personal friends during the hangar party. Well, I said, that is not a problem. Tanqueray gin is one of my favorite drinks, too. Needless to say, I had a wonderful evening with Bob and Colleen Hoover, Jimmy and Wanda Driscoll, along with Eddie Andrini, Wayne Handley, and Amelia Reed. At the end of the evening, Bob suggested that I fly with him in the Shrike the next morning before the show starts. Absolutely yes. I couldn't believe it. I will see you in the morning. I showed up a few minutes early. Jimmy Driscoll grabbed me by the arm, ushered me under the rope, put me in the right seat of the Shrike, and instructed me to stay in the aircraft. About a minute later, Bob steps quickly in the cockpit. Jimmy immediately starts to push the airplane back from the ropes. Out of nowhere, two men from the FAA come out of the crowd. Under the ropes, and they stop the pushback. And then they ask Bob to get out of the Shrike. I'm sitting in the Shrike. I go, uh-oh. Now, keep in mind, I just met Bob last night. Okay? They start grilling, and they say, Bob, what are you doing? Where are you going? Bob, in his cool and disarming manners, you know, seriously. Well, the aircraft is simply too heavy for the upcoming performance, and I need to burn off some excess fuel. The FAA, they cocked their heads, thought about it for a moment. Okay, Bob, go ahead. So Bob gets back in the airplane. I was treated to Bob's entire Shrike air show routine, minus the energy management series, because we were over the Pacific. One of my favorite memories of the ride was how good he was at making his straw hat float around the cockpit. And this is great. After bouncing the hat between my lap and my face repeatedly, at Bob's pleasure, Bob then proceeded to float his hat through the entire length of the cabin, starting from the cockpit, only to land perfectly upright on the rear seat without Bob ever looking back. So Bob leans over, he looks me in the eyes and he asks, "It's on the back seat, right?" I said, "Yes, sir." True story. Bob, you will be greatly missed but loved forever by so many friends that you touched so deeply along your incredible journey. Farewell, my personal friend. Thank you.
Thank you, Red, very much. That's good. That's beautiful. Okay, I'm one of the old guys in the airshow business, and so I'm going to bring up a retired airshow pilot who decided to marry Sandra Lynn and become a movie producer, David Ellison. Thanks, sir.
Hi, I'm incredibly humbled and honored to be standing up in here in front of you today to celebrate the life of Bob Hoover. I first met Bob 20 years ago when I was a 13-year-old kid at the Oshkosh Air Show. My father and I had just begun our journey into aviation, and little did we know what we had in store for us that day. I thought my eyes were deceiving me as Bob shut down both engines of his Shrike, looped, rolled, and landed the aircraft all with the engines off. And if that was enough, he managed to roll perfectly to a stop in front of me to take a little wave to the crowd. After thousands of hours of aerobatic flying and 20 years of aviation, it is still the most remarkable thing I've ever seen in an airplane. When Bob approached the flight line, I ran up and asked for his autograph, which he kindly obliged, and even posed for a picture with me and my father, which is that one there today. Later that day, I was sitting in the cockpit of a BD-5 microjet when Bob walked up to me and asked if I wanted to talk about airplanes. I barely managed to mumble the word yes, and from that moment on forged a friendship that truly changed my life. Being in the presence of a hero will do that to you. I'll never forget sitting with Bob at the Proud Bird and listening to his stories about the X-1 program, stealing a German Messerschmitt, or buzzing your girlfriend's house in the only jet flying over the continental U.S. that day just for good measure. Bob's life in the sky was an adventure followed by an adventure. His achievements in aviation charted his flight into immortality and earned him a permanent residence in the history books. He was the consummate gentleman, humble, kind, and the physical embodiment of the ideals of this great nation that he dedicated so much of his life to serving. Every life that he touched was better for it, and I know we will all miss him dearly. So to that, I just want to say to my good friend, Blue Skies Bob, and God rest.
We're not supposed to have a dry eye, I guess. One of Bob's dearest friends was Jimmy Doolittle, and his little girl's here, Jonna Doolittle, so please.
When I was young, I was a Girl Scout, and Girl Scouts taught me to be prepared, and my grandfather said that the best speeches are short, so I'm prepared to be very short. I can't remember not knowing Bob Hoover. As a little girl, I can remember looking up at him and wondering how he could see anything because he had those Coke bottle glasses that were so incredibly thick. But I knew he was a great pilot, not because of all the cool stuff he could do in an airplane, but because my father and grandfather had such enormous respect for him. Sometimes life gives you special blessings, and getting to know Bob and Colleen as an adult and having the opportunity to call them friends, for me, was a special blessing. In fact, my daughters had the opportunity to get to know Bob, and I repeatedly warned them that even at 90, he still was a flirt. Bob was a gifted storyteller. I think he remembered every flight he ever took and every airplane he ever was in. A couple of years ago, I had an opportunity to go back to Washington, D.C. with Bob, where the Air Force Historical Foundation was honoring him. It was 5 hours there and back, 2 days in D.C., and I never heard him repeat the same story. Now, I have to tell you, he might have repeated them at the bar that night when he closed them down, but that was past my bedtime, so I wasn't there. My grandfather said that Bob Hoover was the greatest stick and rudder man that ever lived. Keep practicing. I'm sure there was a great celebration up in heaven when Bob arrived. Gramps, Scotty Crossfield, Johnny Allison, Tex Hill, and so many other great pilots were there to party with him. But we're going to miss him. I love you dearly.
Bob not only flew in this country, he flew around the world. And I wanted to invite Mr. Rich Lee, he was chief of flight test for Boeing Helicopter Division, who flew in Farnborough and Paris with Bob. So Rich, ladies and gentlemen, Rich Lee.
While performing at the Paris Air Show in 1991, I was asked by Hughes Helicopters to take Bob Hoover on an aerobatic flight. After the demo, he took me aside and took apart my young, wet behind the ears ego with a frank discussion of aerobatic risk. But in true Bob Hoover style, he also helped to help me not to kill myself in the future. I accompanied Bob everywhere that year, and he gave me my first real lessons about display flying techniques and what it means to be an airshow pilot. Conquistadores del Cielo is a secret club of top aviation executives. One year, Bob and I were invited to perform a show for them at the Inn of the Mountain Gods in Ruidoso, New Mexico. Bob flew Old Yeller, and I flew a Hughes 500 helicopter. The density altitude there is well over 9,000 feet, and I'd never flown loops and rolls that high before. I sought Bob's advice when I experienced unintentional departures during practice. Together, we made changes to my show sequence to lower maneuver G-forces, reduce entry speeds, and increase altitudes. Bob, ever the consummate test pilot, also recommended I modify control input strategies by using a nonlinear increasing rate movement to delay G onset. The result was a flawless high altitude show that I was able to use in competitive evaluations and air shows for many years. Bob has been a mentor to Sean D and myself throughout our flying careers. Bob was very aware of image and public perception. And he did his best to teach us about our responsibilities as air show pilots performing before the public. When Sean and I demonstrated what can only be called conduct unbecoming prior to an interview at a TV station in Monterrey, Mexico, Bob was furious. He made us stand at attention, locked our heels as if we were young lieutenants, while he explained our duties as Americans. Sean does a great impersonation of Bob's lecture, which we call the Ugly American Lecture, if you ask him. Bob was the greatest influence on my air show and flight test career, and is the reason I am still alive today. And for that, I will always be grateful. Thank you.
Thank you, Rich, very much. Thank you. Another Society of Experimental Test Pilots, magnificent aviator, Terry Lutz. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Bob Hoover's life has affected many different people in many different ways. In 1968, I was a simple line boy, putting gas in airplanes, servicing airplanes, just to pay my way through college. Bob was flying at the Willow Run Air Show that year, so I introduced myself and offered to take care of his P-51. It was the beginning for myself and for Bob of a very lifelong friendship, and our paths crossed many times over the years. During my career, I faced two major crossroads, and both times I turned to Bob for his advice. As an Air Force pilot, I was thinking about leaving and going to private industry. Bob had a good feel for the industry at that point in time, and he said, you know what, stay in, go to test pilot school. And fortunately, I was accepted, and a few years later, our paths crossed again. I had briefed to chase an F-16 test mission, and I was walking out the door, and I noticed Bob was in the next briefing room. And what he was doing was preparing for an evaluation flight in the F-16. And we shook hands, and I can tell from that you-know-what grin on his face that he was thrilled to be back at Edwards and thrilled for the opportunity to fly the first fly-by-wire fighter. Years ago, I was at another crossroads when I received an offer to join Airbus flight test in France. Bob told me, hey, you know what? That's an opportunity to learn. It's an opportunity to sharpen your flying skills, and you're going to see this industry from a much broader perspective. Well, that simple piece of advice really led to far more than just a job. Through my contacts in France and here in the United States, we have opened doors so that the major airframe manufacturers are now sharing information that can significantly reduce risk in certification flight testing. Bob was always gracious to provide guidance, and with the same firm tone, you knew he would deliver a bit of harsh reality when things were not going well. But you know what? I think his true legacy is not those incredible flying skills or what he taught us about grace and humility. His true legacy is all of us, a generation of people who have shaped their lives and what he taught us. And we'll now pass that on to the next generation. Thanks, Bob. We'll get it done.
Thank you, Terry, very much. And the president of the Society of Experimental Test Pilots, Mr. Erickson. Thanks for coming.
So I'm honored to be here today to convey the thoughts, wishes, and indebtedness of each member of the Society of Experimental Test Pilots to Bob and his family. They've asked me to articulate the positive impact his life has had on generations of test pilots. While everybody's deeply saddened today, we choose to celebrate his life and the contributions of a test pilot, a warrior, and a consummate gentleman. Bob was a lifetime member and fellow of the Society, joining in 1957, only a year and a half after our founding. He was so dedicated to the Society's mission to improve the safety, efficiency, and professionalism of flight test that he was and still remains the only person to twice serve as president. My introduction to Bob was much like yours as a kid up at Oshkosh. Even then, I remember he was different. His performances were different. He was a true aviator, pilot so obviously well connected with his machine that his shows were more akin to watching an artist paint a picture in the sky than an aerobatic act. I first met him personally as a cadet at the Air Force Academy and then later in 2002 at a gathering of Eagles as a new test pilot. After all the formalities ended, as many of you can probably relate to, my wife and I closed down the bar with him and Colleen, talking well into the night, but I directly remember that conversation was more about Bob asking me questions and him specifically not allowing me to ask questions to him. It was this, his ability and desire to share lessons and hear about yours. It was obvious that Bob was all about giving back and making others better, as opposed to pontificating and talking about himself. More importantly, I can attest that mine was not an isolated experience. There are countless others who share similar stories. The legacy that I ask you to remember about Bob every time you strap into the cockpit, board an airliner, or watch an air show, Bob made an indelible mark on aviation as we know it. And more importantly, he will continue to do so as we ever push the boundaries of aerospace into the future. Bob would tell you that we must not shy away from taking risks to advance the state of the art. That is the role of the test pilot. I know with certainty that my company, Virgin Galactic, our disciplined, methodical, and pragmatic approach to expanding the leading edge of commercial spaceflight is shaped by the tremendous efforts and mentorship of Bob. Moreover, his legacy will continue to do the same worldwide at countless other companies and development programs into the future. This is what made him a truly remarkable aviator, and more importantly, a great man and a friend of everyone fortunate enough to know him. In the time-honored tradition of fighter pilots, I gladly throw my nickel in the grass in his honor. Godspeed.
Thank you, Todd. Very much. Very much. Representing the F-86 Pilots Association, Lieutenant General Dan Druid. Come on up.
pleasure for me to be here and represent the life and wealth and great things that Bob Hoover did, and I'm proud to say that I was a friend of his. I met him in mid-1950, and as I was a young captain up in Nellis, and got to know him better as the 50s pressed on, when he attended several air shows and activities at Nellis. In early 1962, I moved to Clark Air Base in the Philippines, and Bob came over to put on a demonstration in the F-100, which you can imagine, it was impeccable. After the show was over, after the demonstration, he took the pilots, both young and old. By this time, I was an older captain. He didn't advance too much in those days. But took them to the club and sat and listened and talked to them and explained his idea of flying and how it could be safe. And to the individual, it was one of the most outstanding things I'd seen an individual do, to see the reaction to those young pilots. And he did this not just for the Philippines, but during the 60s and into the 70s, he was flying demonstrations on basic airplanes that are in the inventory. And it was something that I think, and I've told Bob this before, one of the best things that ever happened to the United States Air Force was when he got out. Because in his capacity as a civilian, he was able to influence more pilots and save more pilots' lives than anybody else. I am privileged to be here and to know that. And all I can say is, rest well, my friend.
Thank you very much. Great. Thank you very much. Now, we all know her. We all love her. She worked so hard to help put on this event, and she made this magnificent movie, The Feathered Edge. Kim first.
Six years ago, I told Sean Tucker I was looking for a subject for a new documentary. Having spent the last 6 years documenting Bob's story and introducing it to a new audience of non-aviators and aviators alike, this is what I've learned from Bob. That it was never about him. It was always about you. How you doing, Bob? Splendid. More importantly, how are you, my dear lady? Every time I look around this room, and I see reflections of Bob. He created this web of friendships and relationships that's part of the fabric of our aviation industry. Heads of Gamma, NBAA, EAA, ICAS, AOPA, SETP, airshow pilots, military pilots, businessmen. Bob's secretary from North American for 12 years. It has been my great privilege to know you and to help forward the legacy of this great man. In addition to being one of the greatest pilots the world has ever seen, the friendships and the connections that he forged are a huge part of what made Bob's life truly special. I am honored to have been able to document them. I love you, Bob. Those guys.
And Matt, we went out of order. Bill, we have time. We went out of order. I'm going to have Matt Jackson come up from Matt's a Reno Air Racer and to talk a little bit about Bob's air racing days. Ladies and gentlemen, Matt Jackson.
I had the privilege of knowing Bob for the last 50 years of my life. And I have to say and speak for every unlimited racer at Reno that ever had the privilege to fly with him, that he was our safety. He was our safety valve. He was what kept us safe up there. And if you look at the history of the Reno Air Races, while Bob was up there, everyone stayed safe. You know, it's a tough thing when you lose somebody like Bob, but as I told Bob just a couple days before he died, We all want to believe in the resurrection, and I hope someday that we'll all be together again and be able to share our experiences and stories as we have in the past. So long.
Thank you, Matt. Another one of Bob's dear friends, very close friends, is Mr. Bill Fanning wanted to speak, say a few words. So please, Bill, walk fast. We got to be on time, over target. Okay, thank you.
I had the privilege of knowing Bob from the time I was 15 years old, and he was a major influencer in my entire life. A few years back, I had the evening of spending with Carol Shelby's memorial service, in which Bob delivered a eulogy that was one of the most touching things that you'd ever heard. After that night, we went back to Bob's house, and we started talking about the eulogy, and I said, Bob, what are we going to say for you? And Bob said, well, Bill, I just want everybody to know that I was the luckiest guy in the world, not for the things that I did, but for the hundreds of true friends that I have. And he said, he used to always joke, and he said that that old Grim Reaper had been chasing him for years, and that son of a bitch ain't got him yet. And he said, but when he does catch me, that Undertaker is going to have a hell of a problem. And I said, well, Bob, what's that? He said, getting the shit-eating grin off of my face. Godspeed,
thank you.
Bob.
Thank you. Hey, guess what? Guess what? We're ahead of schedule. We are ahead of schedule. Yeah, baby. All right. Ladies and gentlemen, Neil Armstrong's son, Mark, he's gonna recite High Flight. And remember, we got the Hoover up there. We got his pop up there. We got all our other magnificent heroes up there. So please, sir.
Oh, I have slipped the surly bonds of earth and danced the skies on laughter's silvered wings. Sunward I've climbed and joined the tumbling mirth of sun-split clouds and done 100 things you have not dreamed of. Wheeled and soared and swung high in the sunlit silence. Hovering there, I've chased the shouting winds along and flung my eager craft through footless halls of air. Up the long, delirious, burning blue, I've topped the windswept heights with easy grace, where never lark or even eagle flew. And while with silent, lifting mind I've trod the high, untrespassed sanctity of space, put out my hand and touched the face of God.
Now, as you can see, stay seated right now, but as you can see, the doors are opening. And what we're going to do on cue, not yet, but on cue, we're all going to proceed out there in a very timely basis, because the program, with great precision and timeliness, will be out there. It will include some tributes on the ground, but it will also include the vast ocean of air above us where Bob lived and performed with a series of flights. The flights will begin as you and I face the sun from our right up to the north and proceed down to the south to our left. With split-second precision and only approximately 15 seconds between the flight elements, at 1,000 feet, the first element, appropriately enough, will be a North American Sabreliner, joined by two F-16s from your United States Air Force Thunderbirds, and joined by a Tudor jet from the Canadian Jet Demonstration Team, the Snowbirds, and that flight will celebrate Bob's induction as an honorary member of the Thunderbirds, the Snowbirds, and the Blue Angels. Yes. Then you'll have to look north again very quickly, 15 seconds later. It will be an Air Force Heritage flight. It will be an F-22, followed by two F-86s. And when asked at an evening dinner one night to Bob Hoover, "Bob, what was your favorite airplane?" he said without 1 second hesitation, "Danny, F-86. So the F-22 and the F-86s will be the second element of flight. And then the third element, which will include the missing man, will be a Curtiss P-40, will be a Grumman Hellcat, will be not only a P-51 Mustang, but Old Yeller. And from Bob's wartime days, the Spitfire.
Ladies and gentlemen, at this time we ask you to turn your attention to the Air Force Honor Flight for the honor ceremony.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your attention, and we are so honored to have the discipline and the respect and the honor that not only you, but the honor guard and our dedicated flyers gave to our great friend, R.A. Bob Hoover.
Let's cue a little traveling music.